Welcome to the Bauer Power Hour, where we pack motorsports, power sports, and the outdoor lifestyle with technology, innovation, news, and good times into an action-packed dirt-flinging show. Hosted by the one and only Charlene Bauer, who's been serving the off-road industry for over 20 years. Time to throw the green flag and get ready for another wild lineup.
Thank you for joining us today. I'm your host, Charlene Bauer, and we are back with another exciting episode of Bauer Power Hour. Today's show is presented by Kicker Audio, BFGoodrich Tires, Discount Tire, the Mopar Pinzel Express Lane, and I'm Not Just a Girl. Did you know that BFGoodrich Tires is entering into its sixth consecutive year with more? They're kicking off their sixth year together with a season-long contingency program worth over $18,000. Pretty exciting. I'll also have to say it was very exciting around here and felt a lot like Christmas a couple weeks ago when a few boxes arrived at the door that I didn't know anything about. Inside were some Kicker products. We've been using the amphitheater in our office since, and I'm really looking forward to using the portable wireless speaker in the buggy. But anyways, okay, let's get back to work. This episode's guests are Brian Grace from Kicker Audio and Scott Fields from BFGoodrich Tires 36 Hours of Uwharrie. Alexis Nelson with ORBA will join our land use segment, then 30-pack Matt will talk tech and tools. And we'll close the show with another social dirt segment. This time, it's all about your off-road pets. But first, for some breaking news. Last fall, Dana Aftermarket launched the What's the Diff marketing campaign along with the Ultimate Dana 44 front axle and ran a successful axle giveaway to celebrate. Following up on that, they are giving away another Ultimate Dana 44 front axle and installing it for the winner at Easter Jeep Safari in Moab, Utah this March. The promotion consists of a questionnaire that will help narrow down the field of entrants to those actually going to EGS. At the end of the questionnaire, the person is entered into the contest. The questionnaire can be found online at spicer.com/whatsthediff. WeRock started their 2016 competitive rock crawling season in Arizona at Thompson's Ranch. There were a number of new pro unlimited teams, teams moving to unlimited from other classes, and seasoned unlimited teams with new buggies that will be expanding the field. The two-day event included four courses of competition on Saturday and another on Sunday, with a final shootout on Sunday afternoon. Tracy Jordan would take the win in the unlimited class after coming back out of retirement. Here's a quick update from the world of AMA Supercross. Joey Savacki and Cooper Webb entered round six of the Monster Energy Supercross Series in a virtual tie, with both riders running the coveted red plate, signifying they are the current 250 SX West Class points leaders. The recent win went to Monster Energy Pro Circuit Kawasaki's Savacki, with Webb following in second. Savacki now has 3 points lead in the series. Congratulations to everyone and good luck on the next race. Rugged Ridge announced the introduction of its new XHD rock sliders for the 2007 to 2016 Jeep Wrangler JK, designed to provide maximum protection for the Jeep's most vulnerable points, the lower rocker panel and pinch seam. The innovative one-piece design is precision manufactured from CNC laser cut 3mm steel plate and finished with a tough black textured coating. Each rock slider also features an integrated 4-inch step to help make climbing in and out of Jeeps easier, especially with lifted vehicles. The rock sliders are designed to function with most aftermarket and stock fender flares. Easy to install, the XHD rock sliders give Jeep owners the option to mount them without drilling into the vehicle body, or for the ultimate in protection, secure using heavy duty rivet nuts. For more information and to see their entire product line, visit ruggedridge.com. All of this news and more is available at offroadnewswire.com. If you have off-road news, please feel free to submit it to winning@bauermedia.com. Do you want to know what cool events are happening this weekend? Check out the news 2016 Bauer Media calendar that's packed with cool events to attend across the country at bauermediacalendar.com. And if you don't already get our weekly newsletter blast with the week's calendar, Bauer Power Hour info, current news, and information from the industry, be sure to go to our website and join in. You'll never be left out of that inside circle again, guaranteed. Well, let's get this show started and get to the phone lines to chat with our first guest, brought to you by Kicker Audio. Kicker Audio.
Hey guys, let's load up!
I love my small town world. I love a country girl. I love a Friday night. Man, I love this life. Sound of an old dirt road rolling through my mind. Man, I love, man, I love, man, I love this life.
There are a handful of exciting and new events that are popping up, and I'm not going to lie, I'm really excited about learning more about this one. Let's welcome Scott Fields from BFGoodrich Tires, 36 Hours of Uwharrie. How are you doing tonight, Scott?
I am awesome. Hope you are, Charlene.
Yes, thank you. So, 36 Hours of Uwharrie. I know we have a lot of things to talk about, but let's start with 36 Hours. That right there just sounds exciting.
Well, it is. It's a very long weekend of challenging trails, shooting, canoeing, and mainly navigating in the Uwharrie National Forest area, private and public lands.
Okay, and for those that aren't familiar, where is Uwharrie?
It's right in the middle of the state of North Carolina. Uwharrie is a relatively small national forest, 50,000 acres. The area that we use and most people use, it has over 1 million visitors a year. We're an hour from Charlotte, an hour from Greensboro, High Point, Winston-Salem, and 2 hours from Raleigh, Durham, Chapel Hill. So we're right in the middle of the state. We've got 6 million people within a 2-hour drive from us. But it's the Baden Lake Recreation Area, specifically the part of the Uwharrie National Forest where we're located. And it is a 5,000-acre chunk that we use.
Very cool. So what kind of terrain? Is it all forest? Is it mud? Is it trees? What are we in for?
Well, it's pretty neat. 30 minutes east of where we're at, you're in the sand hills.
Oh.
And where we are, there is no sand, but we have lots of rock. You'll see a little bit of sand mixed in the dirt, but it's mostly clay. And when clay is wet, it is very slick. So we do have clay, rocks, woods, tight woods on some of the properties, open in some of the other properties, so it really changes. Matter of fact, some of the property doesn't have any rocks, and then other properties that we have is mainly rocks. So it really changes, as well as the elevation. We're in what's called the Piedmont area, plateauish, but the Uwharrie Mountains are claimed to be some of the oldest mountain ranges in the United States, which have over time gone down a lot lower, 1,000-foot peaks now, roughly little under 1,000-foot peaks.
Oh, really?
But we do have some great climbs with rocks mixed in, so lots of fun. This area has become a four-wheel drive mecca here in North Carolina. Once the Teleco off-highway vehicle trail system was closed.
Sure.
Out on western North Carolina. This is now the draw. We draw from South Carolina, obviously North Carolina and Virginia. All the clubs come here. So this is the main four-wheel drive spot for several hundreds of miles, actually.
Wow, interesting. All right, so now that we have the location, let's talk about your business, actually, the Uwharrie Offroad Training Center, because I know the the event kind of stems from that. So let's learn more about your training center. How did it, what do you guys do there?
Well, we fill a niche that we saw was needed. There really wasn't a off-road type training center centrally located on the East Coast. And we started in 2011, mainly started training ATVs to the ATV Safety Institute. Then we grew into four-wheel drives, which is our mainstay, four-wheel drives. And we also train side-by-sides through ROVA. And now we're getting into Argo because just east of here is very much swampland. So the Argo is the amphibious type of vehicle where the power companies like to use them for the right-of-way. So we train a lot of military, a lot of civilians, and some agencies, the commercial and recreational. So we are keeping busy, thank God.
No kidding. That's a long list. So when you say training, I know you're, to some degree, it's just here's how to drive the vehicle, but really it's based on recovery and it's based on terrain, right?
Absolutely. So safety is a number one with us. That is what it's all about, is teaching the driver safety and letting them know that they are in charge of the passenger safety. And from that, it's not just personal safety and vehicle safety, but also terrain safety, if you would. We are also master tread trainers with Tread Lightly, so we take it all very seriously. And from that, it certainly can be broken off into recovery, field expedient repair. It can get into much training on the vehicle itself. Mm-hmm. In other words, overlanding type of training, which is becoming very popular now. Overlanding is growing the leaps and bounds. Mm-hmm. And it's even coming here on the East Coast, and we don't have all the terrain that you have out there.
Yeah. Yeah, but there's a lot to be said about all that type of off-roading. It's so new and so fun.
It is, and we're trying to get into it too.
So what are some of the key elements that you teach people that maybe they wouldn't learn on their own or somewhere else?
Well, we certainly don't want to give the cake away, but we do a lot of two-foot driving teaching.
Mm.
We teach a lot of people proper manual transmission driving skills. You know, the brake is to be used.
Yep.
And God gave us 2 feet, and we're supposed to be using those. And so that is a big part of it. And just coaching people through the obstacles and teaching them how to use both feet, both hands on the steering wheel, all those challenges that come with a lot going on at one time. Now they've got other feet that are in the mix of it. So it's a lot of fun to teach, and it's definitely a skill, a people person type skill, and just being able to get outside their window and walk beside them and help them feel comfortable over very challenging terrain.
Yeah.
And, you know, if a student doesn't have that pucker factor, if you would, while they're training with us, then they just don't get the full Monty. So we make sure that they are on challenging terrain, but all the while in a very safe, controlled environment.
Awesome. So with all that being said, one day you guys came up with this grand idea to have the 36 hours of Uwharrie.
Yeah,
Is that kind of the way this works? Or walk us down the path. It's a brand new event, so how did it get started?
Well, it's kind of brand new. The idea has been around, and There have been triathlon events in the past that we were actually a part of. We actually ran in the 90s. Some of them were called the Safari Triathlon. They were in Florida and Colorado and here in North Carolina as well, back in the 90s and very early 2000. They took place, and we helped organize, we helped pre-run, and we actually ran the event. John Paul Eller and myself ran the event years ago and loved it. We would come back and help and spectate and just wanted to be a part of it. And it was October of 2014 at a Southern Four-Wheel Drive Association Dixie Run, where BFGoodrich is heavily involved with Southern.
Mm-hmm.
And BFGoodrich has been heavily involved in these Safari Triathlons years ago as well. And the gentleman with BFGoodrich, been with them so long, known him for many years through all these events. He just came to me and said, "Hey, Scott, why don't we bring that back? Why don't we do one?" And I said, "Well, you know, that's really interesting. I've certainly been thinking about doing something like that. Would you be title sponsoring right away?" He said, "Yes." So pretty much from there, within a few months, we started putting it together and pre-ran it August of 2015. So it's going to be awesome, and BFGoodrich, very excited. They're helping us tremendously, and their new KO2, there is no better all-terrain tire on the market right now, so we're excited to be a part of that introduction of the tire as well.
Yeah, definitely agree with that. And I think I guess maybe we'll let the cat out of the bag right now, if it isn't already out. The plan is to have myself out there in a Jeep, and
ooh.
I know. So we'll definitely be running the KO2s. That's part of it, is, you know, making sure that it's a normal Jeep. Like, I want to see, okay, here, look, we can participate out there and have a great time.
Yeah, actually, that time of year, August, is a little drier. We'll have afternoon thunderstorms that time of year in North Carolina. So that tire is perfect.
Perfect.
It is absolutely the best tire for the terrain that time of year in North Carolina. So tires alone, you'll do well.
So I am looking at an outline here. It says, "What is the BFGoodrich 36 Hours of Uwharrie?" And it says, "Events may include," which makes me giggle because we know the may is in there, right? High lift jack challenges, winch recovery, steep hill climbs and descents, forging water hazards, traversing varied soil conditions from mud to loose rocky scrabble, and a variety of off-camber positions, which are typical of the rugged Uwharrie terrain. Plus a series of canoe and shooting. All right, so tell us what you got planned for us for 36 hours. Do we ever get to sleep?
Yes, you will get to sleep. the challenges are during the day mostly. We will have a night challenge or two. We are being very secretive because we do not want the competitors to know really and totally what they're in for. and in that, and with that, there's a huge military motif set around this. We will have a forward operating base with 36 tents. It's 36 teams, 36 hours. 36 tents will be set up perfectly spaced in a forward operating base that will be secure. In other words,
cool.
You have to be totally self-sufficient. You cannot leave to go get anything. The only time you'll be leaving the FOB, as we call it, will be when you're out on missions, out on the trails.
Gotcha.
So we will have both retired and active military there, acting like first sergeants, telling the enlisted, which you would be one of them, what to do, and making sure that everything is being handled properly, and all the verbiage. You'll be learning lots of acronyms, as I've had to learn over the years training the military. But that will create a really neat environment and a lot of fun for the competitors that we're calling the enlisted.
Really? So it's kind of military-based in its own way.
It is.
Are we going to have to click our heels and stand in lines?
Well, we will see. We don't want to let you have too much information.
Okay, do we have to run a mile or do push-ups?
No. But you will have to move quickly. We don't want to call this a race, but it is points-based. So, in other words, there will be tasks.
Okay.
And many tasks, and there will be so many tasks that one team can no way complete all the tasks that they're given for the day.
Oh, okay.
So you have to be strategic in choosing which tasks you want to do, and you know, a lot of teams might choose the higher point ones. But one could also gain a lot of points by choosing a lot of the lower point type. There will be mandatory tasks, and there will be tasks that are not mandatory.
Hmm.
So what this event is to throw you off balance. It is not going to be easy mentally, physically, or for your vehicle. It's going to be fun, and our main goal is to give the enlisted the time of their life. So for the year to come before they enter again, because they'll want to for sure, they'll be talking about it, and word of mouth is always the best advertising, and that's what we're wanting to do.
So it sounds like as a pair, as your partnership, there's quite a bit of strategy to it. So you're given this long list, and then you guys have to decide what makes the most sense.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right. And I will say this. The SMART team, when given their information that morning, and I'm not going to say much,
That's fine.
I would say the SMART team is not just going to head out. The SMART team is going to sit back and check it out and possibly plot it out and then go strategically to the points that they want to get.
So you did happen to bring up the word navigation.
Yeah.
Is this going to be something where we're map encompassing, or you actually have a location?
No, it's going to be, we have cell service there now, thank goodness. So you would certainly want map and compass as backup, but we're working right now on getting an app where we can have it on a phone, or you'll be able to use a Google-type app where that can easily be used. We have a brand new tower that was just put up less
cool.
than a year ago, and so we're going to have that use, as well as GPS is going to be needed as well. So,
okay.
You know, the old tried and true map and compass is something that one does not want to forget, and something that one would definitely want to have the knowledge of how to use, just because
sure.
batteries wear out, devices break. We would certainly think that an enlisted team would bring backups, but even backups break. So,
right.
Yes to all of it.
Yes to all of it. I love it. Yes to all of it, but I can't tell you anything. Okay, so if somebody's listening right now and we piqued their interest, how are you guys doing on filling your spots? Do we still have some room left for people to join
yes.
in?
Yes, we do. And we just, it's a great time for you to join. We just had sponsorship step up, and we've drastically reduced the enlisted cost.
Oh, cool.
So it was $1,500 a team, and we have now been able to, because of sponsorship, bring it down to $360 per team member, $720 per team.
Oh, excellent. Wow, that's great. That's great.
So $360 per member, 36 hours, and 36 teams. So we're excited about it, and we're expecting to sell out very quickly now with the reduced cost.
Yep. Well, for everybody listening, watch for a all-girl team to be out there traversing through the mud.
Yeah.
I'll tell everybody later how we're going to come up with my partner, which is going to be pretty fun. But, yep, it's going to be me and another lady out there making this happen, which is scary and fun and oh my gosh.
Oh, you two will do great.
So how do you feel that the sponsors and this event has mixed in with the off-road industry and the events that are happening across the country?
Well, they certainly seem to. BFGoodrich has certainly grabbed a hold of this and helping us tremendously, and we're so excited about that and all the help that they're giving us with this event. But we also have Super Winch. They are our winch sponsor. And Rancho Suspension is going to be joining us as well. And we'll have more and more that we'll be able to relay and give information out on later. But what's so cool about this is Rancho and BFG and Super Winch were so involved in these triathlons back in the 90s. And so we've got that threesome back again. It's really neat to have
cool.
All three back.
Cool. Well, one of my favorite questions, and I look forward to hearing your answer, zip ties or duct tape?
Well, you know, it'd have to be Gorilla Tape. but I actually prefer zip ties. I do. I seem to carry a lot of them with me, and I love those real long, thick ones. They're so strong. I think they're more universal than actually duct tape.
Awesome. Well, you can find out more about 36 Hours of Uwharrie online at 36uwharrie.com and on Facebook and Instagram at 36uwharrie, which is U-W-H-A-R-R-I-E. For those that may not know how to spell it. Final word for us tonight?
Join. let us know. So you can get in here this very first year. The first year is always the best. So join up and let us know if we can answer any questions for anybody out there.
I guess if they don't join, is there tracking going on during the weekend? Is there some kind of coverage that people can track us? Or
yes, we will have through BF Goodrich's pages, absolutely. If not something more than that, we're looking into quite possibly having something bigger and better than that. But right now, it would be through BF Goodrich and their social media.
Cool. Thank you so much for joining us tonight, Scott. And now we'll join Alexis Nelson with ORBA for a few words about our land fight, brought to you by Discount Tire.
When you're driving down the road, the last thing you want to think about is tires. Trust Discount Tire to get you up to speed on the right tire for your vehicle. Log on now to DiscountTire.com for the best deals on tires and wheels. We're America's largest independent tire store. Come check us out, and we'll show you why. And remember, if ever you're not satisfied with one of our tires, please feel free to bring it back. Thank you.
I'm excited to have an East Coast gal on the phone to talk about a different type of land use fights. She has her own consulting firm, Lat Plus Long Resource Group, and is also working with ORBA. Let's welcome Alexis Nelson. How are you doing tonight?
Great, Charlene.
Good.
I'm doing great, thank you so much for having me on the Bauer Power Hour.
Yay. No, thank you. So tell us what you do. What's Lat Plus Long?
Okay, so I own a consulting business that specializes in grant writing and facilitation, and I also help organizations reach their results, or I help organizations obtain their objectives through targeted results. And I specifically assist ORBA with the operational perspective, and I provide services that encompass strategic planning to working with the One Voice community and just being an advocate for motorized recreation and especially being a representative in the Northeast.
So I thought as we were talking earlier, a couple of really cool facts. Like one of the things that you're really into is snowmobiling, and that is a big off-highway motorized access challenge.
Yes, it is. And this winter has been really tricky because we are basically shedding some tears over the weather here. And while we're trying to seek rideable snow, the businesses and the communities are really feeling the sting. And right now, the snowmobile organizations, primarily Maine, New Hampshire, and Vermont, they're seeing a pretty big drop in membership. We're looking at 20 to 40% decline in membership.
Oh, wow.
Yes. And unfortunately, while we can't change the weather, we can make a difference by supporting our organizations and clubs by getting involved.
I was going to say, so regardless of the weather, things still happen.
Things still happen. So it takes a great deal of behind-the-scenes work to put together a trail system. And the behind-the-scenes fixed cost of running a successful OHV program starts and ends with support. So whether you're an enthusiast looking to get outside, a volunteer willing to donate time, mm-hmm. or a club trying to manage a trail system with limited resources, every single action helps.
Mm-hmm.
So if one snowflake happens to hit the ground, there's still a cost of doing business, and that is from insuring and maintaining the expensive grooming equipment to the on-the-ground trail work and preparation during the off-season. So there's this significant financial commitment required to keep trails open and sustainable for future use.
So I think one of the other interesting pieces that we were talking about is private land on the East Coast versus where out here on the West we have a lot more public land. So tell us the difference and the challenges.
Okay. And, of course, this is one of my favorite subjects. I love trails and all things trails.
I love it. I love it.
So what's unique about riding and wheeling in the Northeast is that 75 to 85% of our trail systems are located on private property. So the remaining 15 to 25% of the networks are located on public lands that are managed through cooperative agreements and partnerships with state and federal agencies. And what's phenomenal about this whole thing is it's like a three-legged stool. So you have the private landowner piece, you have the membership support, and then, of course, you have the functionality of the organization. So you have to have those three elements of the equation to have a successful trail system.
Yeah.
And while most of recreational users in the West, they have to work with maybe a couple landowners that are usually typically public agencies here in the East, we have to work with an array of landowners. So you could cross a parcel, you could cross 100 acres and cross three different ownerships. And so if one person decides that they no longer want snowmobiling or ATVing or four-wheeling, jeeping as part of their management plan, then it really creates a challenge for these clubs to manage a connected trail system. And that's where the real challenge is. So mm-hmm. it's finding the right people, on the ground people that have the passion, the drive, and the patience, and of course the effort to do this crazy amount of work of obtaining landowner permission, because that's an essential part of the equation of operating a trail system.
So how do you get landowner permission? Is it something that happens where you guys just have documentation, or?
Yes. Well, specifically in Vermont, because that is where I managed the snowmobile program for over 13 years. Local club representatives would either go to the town clerk's office and figure out who the specific landowner is, where they wanted the trail to cross. So they'd find out their information, and they'd literally do the old school way of knocking on the door or making a phone call and just talking about what their intent is and sharing their story and how they would like to either reroute a snowmobile trail or make the trail system a whole entity. So it's an arduous process, and in the state of Vermont specifically, you have to have landowner permission in order to operate any kind of motorized vehicle, so whether that's a snowmobile or ATV. Fortunately, for most states in the Northeast, their state statutes protecting landowners from liability in the event that there was something that would happen that a recreationalist would happen to sue. So all of the states have really solid, like rock-solid landowner liability laws that cover the organizations and the clubs.
Interesting. So from a big picture perspective, do you think it's easier or more difficult to have open land versus private land?
Well, that's a tough question. I mean, I think that in terms of having to work with private landowners, I think there's that extra step in the process. And I think there's a lot of responsibility placed on the volunteers and the clubs and the associations. However, I think it's really unique in terms of it's this fluid and operating system when it's working really well.
Yeah.
And that's what makes riding, trail riding that is, in the Northeast so special, because it's these systems that connect all these communities together. There's this big sense of pride. There's just this, like, it's this big overall community. And I know that a lot of, and what's crazy is there's, in the last couple of years, the non-motorized community is really working with the motorized community and working on a multiple-use trail system, which I think speaks volumes in terms of having a sustainable trail system, because I think more people are recognizing the value of that, being able to have a snowmobile trail in the wintertime and an ATV trail in the summertime and some mountain biking trails. So I think that this whole picture is just, it's the successful paradigm for a good trail system, a sustainable good trail system.
Well, that was one of my actual next questions, and you just answered it, is a snowmobile trail can be used during the summertime as an ATV, UTV trail, or?
That depends on the landowner, and that's where it's tricky, because while snowmobiling is more of a traditional use that's been around for 40 to 50 years in the Northeast, ATVing is more of a newer use, and it's establishing that accountability and looking at different ways to maintain that trail. So it just depends on where you're at. But in Maine and New Hampshire, they both have really excellent organized ATV trail systems that correlate with the snowmobile trail systems in the winter. So it just depends on where you're at in the Northeast. There's other states are working on programs, but it's really tricky on private land, because snowmobiling is just, it's a different use. And we're definitely working on developing more seasonal summer, fall, spring riding opportunities.
You're clearly the master of the topic of private land. If you had a piece of advice to give to somebody that may be listening that is trying to knock on that private landowner's door, what would you tell them? What do you tell people?
I tell people to smile, relax, be themselves, share their story, talk about what they love about snowmobiling or riding, share their story, share their passion. And if they speak from the heart and talk about how important it is to them and to their club and how important it is to communities and how important it is to businesses. I mean, it's not just about having a great time on the trails. It's also about stimulating the economy and patronizing local businesses. I mean, most of the trail systems connect these communities together, and it provides this incredible economic engine to some of these rural towns that would no otherwise be, they wouldn't exist, they wouldn't thrive. It's because of this recreational activity that's bringing value on so many different levels. So speak from the heart and just tell your story. And I think a lot of people can relate to that.
Yeah.
And I think if people are just genuine about it, I think it goes a lot smoother.
I definitely agree. Well, do you have a final word for us tonight?
I just think that it's really, really important that as the connected and very dynamic motorized community, I mean, we represent a lot of different activities, it's so important that we keep collaborating and working together and keep the discussion open and keep it positive and keep it on target, because that's how we get things accomplished.
I love it. Absolutely agreed. So thank you so much for taking the time to be with us tonight.
Thank you so much, Charlene. I really enjoyed it.
And now I know how much you guys and gals love tech and tools. So let's see what 30-pack Matt has up his sleeve for us tonight. Brought to you by the Mopar Pennzoil Express Lane. Hello, Matt. What do you have in store for us today for Tech and Tool Time?
Today we're working on a 14-bolt, and we're actually doing a ballistic fab shave kit on it and welding it all up and welding a R-Tech truss and pinion support tie-in on it.
Okay, so all kinds of fancy stuff. But let's get to 14-bolt and a shaved 14-bolt. We hear that a lot. What does that mean?
So a GM 14-bolt or a corporate 14-bolt came in like every 2500 or 3500 Chevy since the 70s, and it's like the perfect axle for an off-roader, because it's got a really strong 10.5-inch ring and pinion. It's got a third pinion bearing like a Ford 9-inch, and it comes stock with, it's a 30 spline axle, but it's 1.5 inches, so it's the same size as like a Dana 6035 spline. And it, just the whole package, you know, for $180 out of a junkyard, can't really beat it. And the aftermarket support is huge with it. So, you know, rough stuff disc brake conversion is, you know, so cheap that you just pull the drums off and put on Dan's
sure.
rough stuff kit. And then Ballistic Fab and TMR Customs sell shave kits where you cut the bottom off and you can gain 2 inches of clearance with, you know, 4 hours worth of work. And just the lockers and the ring and pinion choices are just, there's a lot of support for it, and it's because it's such a popular axle.
Okay, so when we say we're shaving a 14 bolt, what does that mean?
So shaving the 14 bolt, if you were to imagine the inside of the diff, there's a little bit of extra room underneath the ring gear to the bottom of the housing, and there's also a lot of extra material on the bottom of the housing. Back before, everyone would just cut that lip off the bottom of the housing and make it it would be a 14 bolt, but after you'd wheel it for a year or so, it'd be a 13 bolt because it would wear the bottom bolt away. And, Ballistic came out with this kit that you cut the bottom of the housing off, and they give you a plate to weld back on that matches up with their diff cover. And you cut 2.5 inches off the housing, but their plate is 1/2 inch thick, so you end up with 2 inches more clearance than a stock axle. And it's actually, it makes a big difference with all the little diff rocks on the trails.
Yeah, okay, so that makes sense. What else do we have to do when you shave a 14 bolt? We also have to deal with the gears, right?
Yes, the gears won't fit anymore. You need to shave the ring and pinion, or the ring gear on the ring and pinion set. Factory, they're 10.5 inches, and when you do the shave kit, you need to shave it down to about 10 1/8, I think. So it doesn't sound like much, and it's really, it doesn't affect the strength very much on the ring and pinion, because the gears mesh more in the center and you're just shaving the outside edge of it off. So the loss in strength is so small that, you know, the gain in clearance is probably way more important.
Cool. Well, I think that really describes what shaving a 14 bolt is, right? Now, when somebody hears that term, sounds more familiar.
Yes.
Well, that's awesome. Thank you so much for joining us today. And now we'll hear your stories on this week's Social Dirt segment, brought to you by I'm Not Just a Girl. Hi, I'm Charlene, and after going to lots of events, I found something missing. Cute girl shirts that actually fit. I said, we can fix that, and now I design a new shirt every other month for the tough girl that wants to tell the world, I'm not just a girl. Available in extra small to 4XL, you can choose between high-quality tanks, tees, or sweatshirts, and we have a whole line of jewelry and gifts as well. Visit imnotjustagirl.com to see all the designs and size charts. Available direct through Etsy, Open Sky, and Amazon, or at multiple events across the country. For this week's Bauer Power Hour Social Dirt segment, we asked fans to submit their off-road pet stories and pictures. There were a bunch of cute furry off-road friends that joined us online. Here's a few of our favorites, including Buster, Shadow, Wrangler, Jamaica, Gracie, Titan, Minn Kota, Maggie, and of course, Piston Oil. Well, if you have off-road stories you'd like to share, drop by our Facebook page every Monday for this week's topic. Post your stories and pictures and be entered for your chance to win a Bauer Power Hour goodie bag and be featured right here on Bauer Power Hour. Well, that wraps up another great episode. If you'd like to learn more about the guests on today's show, visit their page on the Bauer Power Hour's website. Take a minute to like and follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, and subscribe to your favorite way to watch Bauer Power Hour in order to receive notifications of new episodes. If you want to be on our show, know somebody who should be, or heck, just want to chat with us, visit Bauer Power Hour website and click Let's Chat. Well, that's all the time we have for today. And until next time, have a great week in the dirt.
Want to learn more about the guests on today's show? Visit www.bauerpowerhour.com for more information, photos, and videos. Follow us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter by searching for Bauer Power Hour Show for daily breaking news updates.